everyone, my name is Cynthia, let's talk books, and today I want to do a dedicated review to one book that I have given 5 stars to, and that is The Lady's Guide to Celestial Mechanics by Olivia Waite. This is a female-female romance set in the early 19th century, yes, and it was just so fantastic, and I think that a lot more people need to pick it up. It's gotten a little bit of hype because the Rip Bodice picked it for a project that they do in which romance book clubs all over the country pick one book to read at the same time, and this was it. And but I also think that a lot more people would really, really like this book. So I'm here to talk about it today. So first of all, what it's about. So it is a female-female romance in which you're following Lucy Mushelmy, whose father was a very famous astronomer within the story. But Lucy's been doing the calculations for his work for years now without receiving any credit for it. He has passed away, and she's trying to figure out what she's going to do with her life now when she gets a letter from Catherine St. Day, who is trying to find somebody to translate a book by a famous French astronomer into English, and was thinking that Lucy's dad might be interested or would know somebody who would be interested in doing it. Lucy decides that she would be perfect to translate this book, but that she, you know, it's this kind of discussion is better handled in person. So she makes her way to London to talk to Catherine about this translation and about her doing the translation for this. So one of the major themes in the story is class. Catherine is a member of the nobility and she is a widow. So the book deals a lot with, you know, the kind of power she has as a rich widow, because she has a lot of money, and that allows her to live not just a comfortable life, but it gives her a say in what she is able to do and in like the people around her. Whereas Lucy comes from, you know, not super poor or anything, but her father was an intellectual who didn't care that much about money things, and her as a woman is not going to be inheriting anything that her father had. Her brother's going to be inheriting everything, and so she's kind of on her own. She's from the countryside, and so she comes to London not wearing the right clothes, and just clearly is not of the same class as Catherine. When they begin that relationship, Catherine is very aware of like the power she has over this young, kind of more vulnerable woman, and it decides that she's not going to take advantage of the power that money gives her, that instead she's going to use that to help this young woman. But the very self-conscious discussions of class going on with inside Catherine, I thought were really, really wonderful. And I loved hearing, reading those. Right. The other big discussion here is the like patroness relationships, because when somebody was sponsoring an artist, right, when they were going to be the patron of an artist, they had a lot of control over their lives, and a lot of times they wanted to exercise that control, and so there's a very explicit discussion of that in this book. And again, handled very beautifully. Like, it's not something that's brushed aside. It's dealt with very directly, but also, like, this is a romance novel, so we want a happy ending. Another one of the major themes in The Lady's Guide to Celestial Mechanics is that of gender, right? Especially gender in the sciences. Right, so Lucy, when she comes to London, is introduced by Catherine to this intellectual scientific society which is sponsoring the translation for the book. The society, however, does not admit women within the membership, at the same time that they rely on the work of women and the patronage of women for a lot of their work. And that has to be dealt with. The sexism within society is something that the book tackles straight on. And it tackles the historical element of like women were actually taking part in a lot of the scientific development happening in the 19th century. A lot of times they were taking part as the daughters and wives of some of these men. Like, a lot of these women were doing a lot of the transcription, a lot of the observations, things like that for the men, and had actually acquired skills in their own right, making discoveries of their own, but it was all being uncredited. And so and that is true, that has been true for periods of time in Western history in which women did a lot of work and were given no or little credit for it. And so that is a big part of this book, right? At the same time that, you know, the book is centering on like, okay, let's change that. How can we, you know, how can we change that within the context of the story, right? Another big theme is, of course, sexuality, because the main romance here is between two women at a time period in which it wasn't like socially accepted. And yet, I was really happy to see that the book acknowledges that although it wasn't socially accepted or legally accepted for two women to be in a sexual or romantic relationship, that it was a lot harder for gay men. Like, the social stigma was just greater for gay men than it was for women, where two women could live together as like friends in society's eyes. For two men, it was a little bit harder, and so I was happy to see that. However, the book is focusing on the female-female relationships and the fact that they can't get married, that they can't, you know, openly acknowledge their love and the sexual relationship, because there would have been significant consequences to the lives of these women, regardless of whether, like, the women have money or not. And so there's a history of sexuality that is tackled in the book, and it was handled really well, I felt. So then that brings me to the topic of historical accuracy. A lot of modern readers of romance don't like queer romances because they feel they are historically inaccurate, and that is where, as a historian, I can come in and say no. Like, the book actually goes into the fact that these relationships were not even that rare. A lot of times they were just not acknowledged, and so they might have felt rare unless you were looking for them. But, you know, historians have done a lot of work on covering this long, long history of same-sex relationships, and they're not rare. It's not historically accurate to have two women fall in love happily and like to figure out their lives together. So just as an FYI, this is not my specific area of expertise. So in terms of the rest of like the history in here, I felt like it was handled well. But I do want to point everybody to KJ Charles's review on Goodreads, because she points out something that, like, for me as someone who's not an expert in this history, I didn't know. And that is that a lot is made in the book about the lack of female representation in the field of astronomy. But in reality, during this time, there was a very famous female astronomer, Caroline Herschel. Caroline Herschel. And Lucy, as somebody who's very into this world, would have known of this woman and of her existence. And that the book does not even mention this very famous female astronomer, and that seems like an oversight. At the same time, it doesn't fit within the framework of the story and kind of the part of history that the author is clearly wanting to tackle. But I want to make sure to put that in here, because like, that's the only kind of fault I could really find with the story. Otherwise, like I said, it's a 5-star read for me. If you like romance, I think this is one that's worth it. If you like historical romance, then for sure I know that you will like this book. I do have to point out, though, that this is very much in the historical romance category. So for people that know that they don't like historical romance, then I'm not sure that I would recommend this book. I think it can be a good entryway into historical romance, but like, there's a lot of history in this book. Like, there's a lot of like looking at how people live and these discussions. So if you don't like that aspect of the romance novels, then, you know, there are other books that deal with similar themes within the like the contemporary or the sci-fi fantasy categories. So I do want to point that out, that if you like don't like history, don't like reading it, then this book is probably not for you. But if you do, or if you're interested enough in it, then I think this is a very, very good one. I think that this is an excellent one that a lot of people should be picking up. So let me know if you have read this book. Let me know if you plan on picking it up. And don't forget to like this video if you liked it. Don't forget to subscribe if you feel like. All of my social media links are down below. I am most active on Instagram and Goodreads. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.